Hi, Al. Over on the left is some of the boats that have been donated, and Caples Estate is over there, and then this is the New College shoreline in Sarasota Bay. This is College Hall. This is where the forum, the sailing forum, is taking place. It's one of the prettiest buildings on Sarasota.
About a third of our presentations on sailing in Sarasota and Florida West Coast area. And it's sponsored by the New College Waterfront Program and the New College Foundation Boat Donation Program. So, basically, I'm just going to give you an overview of what we have in store for you this afternoon. Basically, it'll be a kind of an introduction of what we've been up to in the waterfront program and in the boat donation program. And that'll be followed by a panel discussion carried on with Charlie Ball and Tom Mayers over there. Tom is the director of coordinator of our New College Foundation boat donation program. So he'll introduce the speakers. But basically, I'd just like to start off and let you know about my contributions to the waterfront program. And I've been attempting to try to integrate the academic program with the waterfront program. And to that end, I've been offering a course entitled The History, Development, and Practice of Maritime Technology. So in that course, the objective is to start off talking about shipbuilding and boat building techniques, beginning with prehistoric eras, going to the ancient period of time, all the way to the modern, and then at the same time offer the students an opportunity to get some hands-on skills in the rehabilitation and maintenance of our fleet, as well as upgrading and modifying or rehabilitating some of the boat donation boats that we got courtesy of New College Foundation Boat Donation Program. So we have some hands-on experience as well as some academic exposure to this in the typical liberal arts fashion. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce the Nick Fraser, who's a member of our sail racing team. We just formed our sail racing team last spring, and we've been given provisional membership in the New College Collegiate Sailing Association of North America, and Nick can tell you what we've been up to in that regard.
David Peterson, our waterfront manager, first recruited me about maybe the last semester or so, and my first impressions of racing, sail racing, I grew up in Houston, Texas, which is more out there, was if you could turn a jet, you could race sailors, right? That jet. And four dozen old tacks later, a little better idea of how to race. But, I mean, our sail program, we race
sounds like I'm carrying well.
Can hear you the best of everyone that spoke so far.
All right. The new college waterfront program actually is fairly a new thing. We started with the sail club many years ago. I've talked to John Craner, who's an alum from, what,
67.
And while he was here, someone secured money from the student activity committee to buy a sunfish, and they tied the sunfish up to the dock over here. And you know, every time a storm came, it would get destroyed. They'd go buy a new sunfish, and they'd sail the ones that were beat up, and try to race the storms in, and all that. And this went on and grew for quite a while until about was it 3 years ago that we had it all came to a head. Right. And we had a very competent string of people running things, and we were lucky they were just students doing this as volunteer work because they liked to. And then it got into the hands of somebody who didn't really sail very much. And by the end of the season, all the boats were broken. There was a student's sunk boat out in the bay right off our beach, and they closed the waterfront down. And didn't even put anything away, or just walk away because you couldn't come and sail anymore, so why would you go down there? So then you get hurricanes coming our way. That was the summer of Charlie, and I stepped up and I said, you know, I made them give me the key, and some of the groundspeople came and helped, and we put all the boats away. And it's kind of like the old Army movies where you have all the guys standing in line and they ask for volunteers and everybody does this except for the one poor fool. That's me. But we've come a long way now, and we have a beautiful place where we can sail out of. It's a beach environment, so it's great for sailing small boats like FJs, 420s, day sailors, sunfish, that type of stuff. And I'm finding that we've gone to last week, as well as going to USF, we went to Eckerd, and a lot of these well-funded waterfront programs actually sit in places where you have to sail the little boats out past you know, big, huge industrial ports, like with USF, you're sailing past the Coast Guard station, and you're sailing past you know, a number of ships in your little boats. And here we've got this beautiful beach on Sarasota Bay, which I'm finding is probably the best sailing water around. You know, the winds here are constant, and look at the view. And so that's one of the reasons I've stayed around. It's like our little piece of heaven on earth. We started a boat donation program to fund our activities, and we've taken in a number of boats, and we're doing pretty well in that respect, but we need to start selling some. This boat was donated by the Youth Sailing Program. We tried putting youngest person to single-handedly circumnavigate the globe. Was that the thing?
Yes.
And it was on the same kind of boat. It's a big scrubber, though, and we'd sell it for $1,200 or any kind of offer. Another boat we got donated, it's a Luger, and it's for sale, too, for $1,500. It's actually a pretty nice boat for, like, doing a camp or something. It's very roomy. And we got one of Charlie's boats. And that's the Sunflower. That boat actually is not really as, we're not actively trying to sell that as much as the others. That's a boat that a new college student who later died in Puerto Rico and I picked up off the bottom of the bay. Somebody crashed on our bayfront. We used to store all of our boats back in the old days on the beach because we didn't know about galleys. And we were afraid that a storm was going to blow it up and crush all our boats. And so we found out that the guy had actually sold it to a fellow, and the guy was making payments to the purchaser, and he never took possession of the boat. He disappeared when he crashed it, and so the gentleman who sold the boat gave it to us, and we had it ever since. We really enjoy it. Nice boat. And we've gotten into having our sailing team now, as Nick just was here to attest to, and we went up last Sunday to USF, and we came in first in the second race. Here's Sarah Newberry and Elizabeth Hammond coming in after their first place finish in the second race, and I mean to tell you, that made me smile ear to ear. I was so proud, because here Eckerd, for instance, has 38 boats. They can put 72 competitive sailors on the water at once. They've got a fleet of 20 brand new 2007 boats. They can simulate these races for their team every single day, whereas we have two boats and one leaves. So, for me to simulate a real racing start is just kind of impossible. But nonetheless, Sarah and Elizabeth came in first. And here's Nick and Alice, and they placed very well too. They sailed wonderfully, and it makes me feel that my efforts have been worth it. We also had another sailor, Ian Finnerman, who participated in that race. And I got to say, I'm very proud of them all, and they represent the future of sailing. You know, they've just gotten into the sport, and they're having a great time, and that makes me smile. That's one of the reasons I do this. You know, I go over to the squadron, and there's nothing wrong with it, but the average hair color is white, you know? And, you know, nothing wrong with it, just because there's snow on the roof, doesn't mean there's a fire below. And I've been taken to school by some white-haired people on East Scouts, let me tell you, they finished way in front of me. So, but we need to get new blood into the sport, too, so that one day Nick will be a white-haired guy sailing, I hope.
Yeah, I hear that.
And so I'd like to pass the baton here, and Tom Mayers will talk to us now.
How are you finished? Okay.
Thanks, that was good.
Hi, my name is Tom Mayers, and I'm a New College graduate, and I've been familiar with New College since as long as I can remember. It's a great location, and location is what it's all about. You've got Sarasota Bay out here. It's a beautiful bay. You just look out the door. So I'm supposed to introduce myself and introduce the other people on the panel, Charles Ball and Charles Morgan. My name is Tom Mayers. I've put together a little book of photographs of just some of the sailing that I've done, and then also I have an ancestor that had the first passenger carrying boat that came from Tampa to Sarasota on a regular basis. And he was an important figure in the early days of Tampa. He was on the Tampa City Council. He formed the Tampa Yacht Club back around 1900. So I'm just going to pass this around and show some sailing pictures, some pictures of
you know, historical pictures of mistletoe and my great uncle. And, you know, if you have any questions at all, now each of these individuals on this panel, including myself, has an extensive background. I started sailing in Optimus prams that were designed by one of my favorite designers, Clark Mills. As a kid, we had an Optimus pram fleet on Longboat Key, and then I moved up to Sunfish, and then at an early age was racing sailboats. I remember right off of New College here, we were racing these boats that were kind of radical for their day. They were called Morgan 27s, and they're medium displacement, medium to light displacement. What would you say, Charlie? Medium displacement. And there was a whole fleet of them. It was an active fleet. We had some great sailors, and it would be one of the hot classes back in those days, around 1970. And I remember sailing off of New College, and we're sailing down the bay on a lake. We had our spinnakers up. We were on a close reach, and it was gusting. The wind was gusting, and then, you know, all of a sudden, the guy steering the boat lost control. I don't know why that happened, but for some reason, we lost control, and we wiped out. We put the mast in the water, and all of a sudden, I'm standing on the side of the boat, which seemed the best place to stand, because there was really no place else where you could put your feet, since the boat was over on its side. But that was right off of here. It was the boat that Charlie Morgan designed that I still think was one of the most progressive designs in the history of sailing around here. So these two individuals, Charlie Ball, I remember sailing with him. We were at the Quarter Ton National Championships, and we lost the halyard up the mast. We had to get the halyard down in order to be able to put the jib up. When we got to the next mark, when we had a spinnaker up, and Charlie was the lightest, and so he was going to go up the mast. Another guy, Dave Black, was steering. Charlie looked at Dave real seriously before he got in the bosun's chair. I know the wind's blowing 20 to 30 knots, and we're offshore, you know, outside of land, sailing this race. And so Charlie, as he's going up in the bosun's chair, he looks seriously at Dave Black, and he says, "Whatever you do, Dave, don't jibe the boat." So he goes up to the top of the mast on a 24-footer, and the weight is really important. Such a small boat, he's up at the top of the mast getting the halyard, and of course Dave Black is looking up at him and he jives. And so Charlie went in the water on one side, and then he came back up and went in the water on the other side. And so the whole thing would have been just sort of a little isolated incident, but somebody from one of the sailing magazines, the local sailing magazines, got a picture of him and he was on the cover. So Charlie and I did a lot of sailing together. We have a lot of history. And each of these individuals, as they introduce themselves and explain their history, just realize that they may have such an extensive background, they may overlook something. I remember a Charles Morgan, 26-foot outboard.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so Charlie has a background in motorboating as well as sailing. He's the America's Cup. And these are things that I don't know any one individual on this coast of Florida that stands out more than Charlie Morgan in racing sailboats and sailboat design. I've told this story before, but it's one of my favorite stories. So I was in Morgan Yachts. I was working with B&R Designs. We were doing masts and riggings for sailboat. And we were in Morgan Yachts, which was a really impressive building. You're talking about, you know, a building that as far as you could see, there were just desks and people sitting at the desks, and I was just in the engineering department. And so we were talking about different things that we were doing, and one of the things that we were doing was we were swaging directly on to stainless steel rod. And so Charlie had been involved in the America's Cup, and so when Lasse was off talking to Ron Holland or Craig Walters, Charlie said, "Well, you know, is this proprietary?" And I'm sitting in this big building with all these desks. I didn't know what proprietary meant. I just sort of shrugged my shoulders and kept my mouth shut, and I thought that was probably the best thing to do. And so anyway, that's how I remember Charlie, as he came up with the word that is to them, but my background goes to boat building. We built a boat that won the World Ocean Racing Championship, and almost all the boats I ever did, I never understood anybody describing boat building other than composite construction. So that's sort of what my perception of boat building is, that if you're building wood boats, it's composite boats, because somewhere somebody's putting a piece of fiberglass in, or somebody's attaching wood with stainless steel screws. Fiberglass boat building's the same thing. So I'm going to introduce Charlie Hall and let him go and explain what he's been doing. And I know one of the things that Charlie's done lately is near and dear to his heart is a 40-foot trawler that he built from scratch, from a custom design, and it's a shoal draft trawler. And there's some things I think we could, all three of us, agree on, and one thing is the importance of shoal draft in this area.
My grandfather lived in Red Rock on the bay, right off Camino Real, and tremendous sailing club. In fact, it's probably the best sailing club in the world. So get out there. If you don't have a boat, you can still go sailing out there. They're always looking for crew. And I started sailing out there on a windmill, another boat designed by Clark Mills. I think Charlie Morgan sailed a windmill before, and it was a great racing class for a number of years. 16-foot sloop, I think 119 feet of sail area, and it would plane on any kind of close reach. If you had a breeze, it would go fast. And sail those, sail jet 14s. And then when I went away to college up at the University of South Florida, incidentally, I sailed up there on a 24-foot trimaran. Had my duffel bag and a trimaran that Dave Black and I had built, and sailed up to the Bay campus of the old maritime station in St. Pete, and offloaded my duffel bag, and they sailed back to Sarasota, and I was in college. That's where I went to school. That's where I started racing against you. Yeah, and old barracks buildings, and they're only about a half mile from the yacht club. So naturally, after class, I wandered down to the yacht club, and I ran into an old guy named Pokey Wheeler. And Charlie, I remember Pokey Wheeler. We whipped your ass a few times. But Pokey had a schooner, a 33-foot schooner, and he was always ready to get some free labor, and so. As I recall, Pokey was tight as a frog's ass.
He was.
And that's watertight. And so he had this hull built. It was a Ted Brewer design. And he was finishing off the inside himself. So I helped him finish it off. And in return, I started ocean racing with him. And we sailed that first season. And it was really a bit of a rule beater. At a 27-foot water line, but it only rated like 23 or something under the CCA, or maybe a little more than that. But on a reach, we could really do well. So we sailed that boat that season, did pretty well. And with some folks from Eckerd College, we had a crew from there and from Sarasota. And then we sailed that boat up to Chicago, for the Chicago Mackinac Race. Pokey Wheeler and I, the two of us, sailed that boat up to Chicago in the summer of 66. And got second in our division out of 92 boats in the Chicago Mackinac. And then I came back to school and started racing with an old Frenchman from Sarasota, Peter Truchot. And he had an Allied Seabreeze 35 that couldn't get out of its own way. But we raced that for a season, and then he went to buy a new boat, and he got a Bristol 39 designed by Ted Hood. And we raced that boat for a while, and that boat was a lot of fun, and it was a fast boat. In the Southern Circuit, we got second in our division and fourth in fleet in the SORC back in 1968 or 69, when there were probably a couple hundred boats in the SORC back then. It was a really competitive and one of the premier ocean racing circuits in the world. And I guess the point I'm trying to make is that Sarasota, Tampa Bay, But anyway, I didn't want to go to the bathroom because I didn't want to miss anything from about this 12-meter project. And as Tom said, we raced in the quarter-ton Peter Truchot, the same Frenchman that I raced with, put together a quarter-ton boat to sail in the Nationals, and we actually sailed that same boat in the World Quarter-Ton Championship out in Corpus Christi, Texas, racing for the French because we didn't qualify for the Americans. But we raced for the French, and we were the top production boat in the world.
We won the biggest trophy.
We got the biggest trophy. We were the top European boat, the top production boat, and I think we were sixth in the world, sixth or seventh. I don't know, it always gets better as you go along, but that was a tremendous experience. We've sailed in a number of national championships, and my experience in those is that your learning curve is just so steep. If you ever get a chance to go to one, go. Don't be intimidated by the fact that you're going to get your butt kicked, because you're also going to learn an awful lot from those sailors. I can remember in the World Quarter Ton Championship, we got our race finish improved in every race. And the first race, we had a new half-ounce spinnaker that was just one color. This was when half-ounce came out, and it was pink. And it was a solid color. We generally had sails that had three or four different colors in them. But I set it sideways. We were the second boat at the weather mark. I was on the foredeck, and I set it up sideways. And so he would run the thing up. We got the foot stretched between the halyard and the tack, and we're trimming it back off the stern of the boat.
I was with you on that.
We were like, of course you were. We were like the second boat to the weather mark.
We were the first boat.
We were the first boat to the weather mark.
In the world championship.
But that didn't last long. So. I caught a bunch of it for that faux pas on my part. That's right. So after the race, I wrote "tack" here on the sail because they all look the same. But at any rate, growing up here was a tremendous experience, tremendous sailing experience. I've been sailing all my life, and most recently in the sailing side of it, I built a Bruce Kirby designed 31-foot Sharpie. Draws 18 inches back to the shallow draft thing. If you're going to buy a boat around here, buy shallow draft. That's got to be a top criteria. If for no other reason, it lets you have a lot more places to dock it and a lot cheaper places to dock it. You probably got a friend that's got a dock that's got 3 feet of water at it, but you're not going to find one with 6 feet that doesn't have a boat at it. So shallow draft is a good thing. And it doesn't mean the boats aren't seaworthy. I circumnavigated Cuba in that boat, and I sailed down to Belize in that. And encountered some weather, and it performed fine. Since then, we built a 44-foot trawler designed by a guy named Dave Gear out of New York. And I just took that boat up to Maine at the beginning of the summer, and I'm heading back up the end of this month to bring it back down. So it's a tremendous place for boating, and if you don't get out there and do something, you're crazy. And if you don't get out in the sailing squadron, if you want to go sailing, you're crazy. So I'm going to turn this over to the real master here, Charlie Horvath, who has been doing this for a lot years longer than I have, more than he'll want to admit. But he is the local guru, and we've all grown up seeing his boats everywhere we go. You guys have all seen his boats if you've been out on the water at all. The Out Island 41s, but the real 41, I think, was a much prettier boat, and I'm sure Charlie will agree with me on that. His 41 that he came out with back in the late 60s, I believe it was, centerboard boat, beautiful boat. I used to sail with a local guy here, Jay Miller, that had one, and that was a sweet sailing boat. And if you get a chance to get on one of those, go ahead and do it. Anyway, Charlie Moore.
Seasick and tired just listening to it. my first comment would be about your sailing program here and getting a good intercollegiate dinghy racing team. I put a lot of emphasis on that. Competitive sailboat racing has certainly added, the experience has shown, and certainly in my life, in the history of a lot of people around here, has just made their careers and that feel free to interject at any time with questions, because the whole history of this coast and sailing in general around here is just so multifaceted that almost you could talk 5 minutes without opening up an entire idea or sector of interest. So we don't have much time in these little get-togethers we started having. I hope that it's very helpful in the long run for generating better activity here at this club with the sailing team. And also to raise some money and donations. So anybody have any questions? I'm sure there's a lot of things about this story that you want to question.
Well, I have a question. At one time you said that Morgan Yachts was producing one Morgan out of Island 41 a day. Do you have any idea how many boats you produced at Morgan Yachts? And is Morgan Yachts still in existence?
Morgan Yachts is in existence in the sense that it's a division, a product line, limited edition vessels at Catalina Yachts. I had started that company
5 minutes until we're going to stop. We're taping this for the future. So we have 5 minutes open for questions. If you have any questions, then we're going to take a 10 to 15 minute break. We have refreshments in the back. You all are welcome. And then we're going to come back for another question and answer period. So of whatever length it lasts. So is there anybody who has a question?
Spun around and had to go back out, and I just approved. Somebody else had a hand up. We had a question over here.
A quick one. What's your favorite anchorage on the West Coast?
Well, you know, I've been asked that many times. I don't know. I was always too busy to really be a genuine cruising saver. And I find it, I love it. Pine Island Sound, I love Sarasota Bay and all along here. I used to hurriedly run up and anchor up behind the Big Rock Key in the afternoon or the mornings and swim with my children and go back and watch the tennis matches in Sunday afternoon. You know, I don't really know because I'm not a modified cruiser.
Okay.
But there are plenty of good places around here.
Yeah, the West Coast of Florida is different from like the Caribbean, where there's just a real premium for harbors. I mean, you have Sarasota Bay, and any time you look out on Sarasota Bay, and you see very few boats. And if you have, you know, a shore that's protected, you've got just a limitless number of places to anchor and be safe. So, you know, the whole coast of Florida is like that. It just offers an unlimited number of anchorages, where if you go to the Caribbean, they're a real premium.
Now, Charlie beat around the bush a lot about this favorite boat thing, but I've got a couple of his, and one in particular that I like the best. He designed some really beautiful, large ocean-raising boats, including Rage, that he mentioned, and Maradea, which is a beautiful boat. But my favorite was Panacea, which is a yawl that was owned by Jack Eckert, and he raced it around Tampa Bay for a long time, and that was a 54-footer, I believe, and I thought it was just absolutely beautiful.
I'm in touch with the owners these days. For a long time, I lost track of them, and they have now, here's a very interesting story. The family that owns that boat bought her now 27 years ago, and she was custom designed for Jack Eckert and Ruth, and they didn't expect to campaign it as a racing boat, and we were doing the design phase, and Jack came in one day and said, "Oh, I'm thinking maybe I might want to race that boat sometime." I said, "Jack, you got to stop right here and tell me that if you want to race that boat, we have to go to work and do a lot of redesign because I'm designing a cruising boat for you." And he said, "Well, can I have another week to think about it?" Well, I had spotted it. Captain I proposed for him. That was a very famous Harold Balcom of Tampa, who was an Australian shipmate who fell out from the end of World War II for me. And I got together with Jack and his captain to be, and we talked about it. He said, "Well, I think I kidded him and told him I didn't believe he'd be a good loser." And so she became a cruising yacht appearance with a racing underbody and a sailplane under the Cruising Club of America handicap rule. So we got her out and she did perform extremely well and had a lot of records that she got. And Jack got interested in politics and sold the boat, and she went. I heard from a father in Gibraltar. And he had some information about the boat, and we got in touch. And I never heard from him until three years ago. Well, they were the owner was in town. He and his wife were in town because their daughter was getting married. I found out about that. It turns out that she was a commander of a C-130 out at the Coast Guard station at St. Pete International Airport. Well, the more I found out about it, they told me, well, they had educated their children aboard this boat as they had sailed around the world some 40-odd thousand miles, and for a period
going. Why don't you show it again?
We made a series of talks last year, Charlie, and so we wanted to